Kendrick, man. My guy. New York's been a long time, brother.
Man, real talk. Hey, how you been?
I've been good. How about you?
Yeah, man. Working, man.
Okay, I already see it.
Yeah,
man.
that.
I mean, yo, I feel like we do these. We don't do them often, but we do it when it's important. I feel like every album we spoke for OD. I think we did the freshman cover around OD.
Yeah, man. Some years back, some work.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Section 80. Section we definitely 80. Sat down and talked.
Every album.
Yeah.
Every process.
I think the last time I interviewed you was about 3 days before Good Kid, Mad City came out. It was leaking all over the place.
It was leaking.
I'm trying to grab the leak so I have things to talk about. But we spoke and sat down in Vegas, and that was a great interview.
Definitely.
And here we are, the Pimp a Butterfly, man.
Man, journey.
How relieved? I know you worked hard on this. Was there like an exhale once it came out and you were done with it?
Yeah, definitely. It was an exhale once we the final mix. Mm-hmm. Because it's so much, for me, it's so much of a spiritual process in making the album. I gotta really feel connected to the music. I gotta feel connected to what I'm talking about. And that can drain you, you know, because you're pulling all these different emotions out. You're grabbing all these different experiences around the world and all these different conversation pieces. And you almost have to reenact that because you can't. The time I got inspiration, I probably was on the road. I didn't have no tour bus to record. So I got to pull that energy back out, you know, and locked in with the same people for 6-7 months to a year. Mm-hmm. That's a big release getting down to that last mix, a big relief. So it's a blessing, man.
When did you decide upon to Pimp a Butterfly? Did you know coming in that's what it was going to be, or was there a process of recording and filling out in the studio and then the concept for this album came to you?
The concept, I knew that was going to be the concept. I didn't know if that was going to be the title. What's a trip about that title? And I just seen on this blog called what's that Top Dog? No, Dead End Hip Hop. Was that Dead End? When they was talking about To Pimp a Caterpillar. Yeah, To Pimp a Caterpillar. That was the original name, and they caught it because the abbreviation was Tupac. T-U-P-A-C. And that was the original point once I got the interview.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Right. So I'm coming with the idea, and me changing it to Butterfly, I just really wanted to show the brightness of life, and the word pimp, it has so much aggression.
Right.
And that represents several things. For me, it represents using my celebrity for good. Right. You know what I mean? Another reason is not being pimped by the industry,
right,
through my celebrity.
Right.
You know, so it gets even deeper than that for me. I could be talking all day about it. But
it was almost called To Pimp
A Caterpillar. A Caterpillar, yeah. And shout out to them, too, for picking that up. Yeah. Real talk. That's
they just got a major look.
That's good minds, man. That tripped me out when Top Dog showed me that, for real, that somebody actually caught that.
Let's get into the first song, Wesley's Thing.
Yeah.
You know, and I look at the titles, I look at track lists before I go in. I ain't know where you was. I was like, who's Wesley?
Yeah.
And you go in, and it almost feels to me like you're playing this character. When I get signed, homie, I'm going to act a fool.
Yeah, yeah. This is one of my favorite records off the joint. First off, the lyrics is me going back to that feeling of what I wanted to do when I got signed. These are actually real thoughts.
Right.
You go back to that same mentality when you get some money. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I'm gonna go do this for the homies. I'm gonna take them around the world, let them see things they never seen before. You feel me? And that was the energy. Everything was a time capsule. I just couldn't put it out. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? That was a time capsule, that was a moment. But the overall theme of the record, why I love it so much, is because it talks about something that we weren't taught in school when we get this money. I'd spent all my time in school and escaping prison and escaping the system. So you mean to tell me the moment I become successful and I get some money and I don't know how to manage my money that you're going to throw me back in jail for taxes?
Well, you had the line, educated, but I got $1 million check.
Exactly.
So nobody's prepared you for, and this is how it relates to Wesley Snipes. They might Wesley Snipes your ass.
Nobody prepared us for this. Nobody. Mm. It's so important. They teach us everything else in these curricular activities. redundantly.
Well, how did you learn? Because I mean, though you start off when I get signed, homie, I'm acting fool.
Learn.
I don't see you acting. I don't see the big chains. I don't see. Yeah. Maybe you got them tucked somewhere, but you kind of always seem like you had your head straight.
Yeah, that's the likes of God putting that. I didn't learn from person. I didn't learn from man. That's me, him putting something in me to know, okay, you have a lot of responsibility. But I wouldn't say I know 100% today.
Right.
And it's these are steps. As the more fortune I get, the more success I get, these are things I gotta learn and standards and delays. I gotta learn how to put money out and the things I work hard for and accepting that, because you can't run from it, whether you're rich or whether you're poor. And it's just a system. So I put that through my music to give game to the kids that it's not being taught in them schools. It's up to me, because I'm going through it. And just like every other artist going through it, whether it's me, J. Cole, or whoever, you know what I'm talking about.
When I listen to songs, I visualize things. Maybe it's because this is the first song plus the album cover. But I envision the album. I envision the album cover in front of the White House.
Yeah.
And your people's just mobbing.
Yep.
Acting the fool.
Acting the fool.
What was the impetus for that White House cover? Because that's a statement just
it's
in itself.
It's several meanings. One of the meanings is Wesley Theory. You know, that song inspired that cover. For me personally, It's going back to the neighborhood and taking the folks that haven't seen nothing and taking them around the world, whether you want to call them ignorant or not, they need to see these things, whether it's the White House, whether it's Africa, whether it's London,
Robben's Island.
Exactly. Yeah. They need to see these things. And that's one explanation for it. It gets a little deeper.
Okay. Let's move on, because I want to get through some of these, man. I want to give the people, these are the things that the people want to know, because we've gotten to sit with the album for a couple of weeks, and now we got questions. King Kunta, to me, feels like, and there's a message in that, but out of all the songs, it might feel like the most rappiness, pounding my chest, like, listen, don't get it twisted, I'm giving you knowledge, but I'm still the king out here.
Yeah, it's it can go either way, and I wrote it just because of that, and I want it to be not as complex as a lot of my lyrics, but still have a message behind it, The actual rhyme and scheme of things is simple, and all about rhymes, it seems, so
you
hear me a few times and say, I like that. But I want to make that real simplistic in a boastful way, but also have having a sense of integrity, behind it. I've been called many things growing up, in the state of just being a black man, I've been called, many things from my ancestors. They've been called many things, but it's taking that negativity and being proud of it and making it to your own, saying I am a king, no matter what you call me. And along with that, I think it really just shows heart, heart of who I am,
It's
always from the music.
Sound 8 feet tall, that record.
Yeah, man. Got a short dude out here. Like a giant.
You do have one line, though, that when you call out, say, I could respect rapping.
Yeah.
With a Ghost Rider, man.
Yeah.
Or the rapping.
Yeah.
There was a time when having a Ghost Rider in hip-hop was a no-no. Like, your career was done if that was found out. And I think this generation, we've grown more accepting of it, and it seems like hip-hop has gotten past that.
Yeah.
But you seem to draw a line in the sand, and I was wondering what
all the time,
that.
All the time. I got in the game ghostwriting, and I know how much work and how much ethic you need behind that. So at the end of the day, it's really about respecting that. Respecting these writers, but also as a new artist, you have to stand behind your work, man, and you have to really truly honor the code of hip-hop as a new artist. I'm not mentioning the older guys that already laid down the foundations and have the accolades and things like that. The new kids that's coming in this generation, we weren't taught that. We shouldn't be taught that just because the time is new. We need to go in there and be creative as possible. Be creative as possible, and if you do, if you do have help, acknowledge that help. You know,
who you seen with a ghostwriter? Can we talk about that?
Oh, no, I can't say who I seen with a ghostwriter, but
I knew you wasn't gonna answer that, but nah, I was like,
but it just.
But it's even like a newer generation.
It's
of
a newer
MCs.
Generation. Wow. It's not even about who. It's the new kids. You know,
gotcha.
We got to stand behind that pen and honor your pen because growth is everything.
Right. Well, I'm glad you took that stance. Like I said, I think we become a little lenient.
Oh, yeah.
On that situation, and it was refreshing to hear you take that stance.
Definitely.
So I commend you for that.
Definitely.